Are we live? Yes, we are live. Good afternoon, everyone. Let me introduce you to myself. I am Yasmin Seth, an alumni student of Banjara Academy, DCS Batch 23. And recently I moved to Mysore, but Banjara is a place which you always feel like coming back because it's your home and a place where you learnt the true way of living life with Dr. Ali. So I'm here, and let me tell you a little bit about Mysore. It is a city of palaces, heritage structures, and delicious Mysore Pak. If ever you want to meet all these things and to tickle your taste buds, please come to Mysore and you can give me a shout and I will be there to take you around the city. And as promised, every Saturday, Dr. Ali of Banjara brings to you something that will, a topic that will empower you and help you to self-reflect upon. Well, coming to the point, today's topic is growing old while you are young. In the bloom of youth, some carry burden far beyond their years, whether it is the weight of the responsibility or the scar of the adversity. Growing old while you're young is a heavy journey. Let's listen to Dr. Ali, and he's going to give us an insight of the topic, and we could learn how to support and how to navigate the path of empathy and understanding, fostering the world where youth can thrive without a premature age, while So it's a pleasure and an honor for me to present our beloved teacher, mentor, Dr. Ali, on this FB Live. So please join me to welcome Dr. Ali. And Ali, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Yasmin. And it's always a pleasure to get back our old students, and more so those who are not in Bangalore, who have gone to different places, and they are doing wonderful work over there, and in that process, becoming younger and younger and younger. So today's topic, growing old when you are young. So when are you young and when are you old? The first thing to remember is that you need to understand that growing old can be chronologically. That means you count the number of years. I am 5 years old, I am 15 years old, I am 35 years old, I am 55 years old, etc. The other is the physical growth. People who are fit and fine say that I am young regardless of my age. I can still run, I can walk, I can do this, I can do that. So physically you are young. The third and most important, according to me, is the mental and emotional age. In fact, I put them both together, mental age and emotional age. To me, they are the same. So how much do you believe that you are old or you are young? There was this lady who was about to celebrate her 60th birthday, and people came to wish her and said, "Oh, you're having your 60th birthday." She said, "No, I am 16 years old with 44 years of additional experience." And that brings us to another very interesting thing, and that is that you are as old as you think you are. That is something which is very, very obvious. Just to give you an example, my grandfather lived up to the grand old age of 97. And till maybe 6 months before he passed away, he was fit and fine. He used to walk 5 kilometers. used to do all his chores by himself. And the only thing that used to irritate him and make him angry is if somebody called him old man. He would say, I'm a man. What do you mean old man? What is the difference between this young man and old man, and why do we have to define people like that? So that's just one example. I know innumerable people like that, you know, who are old but consider themselves young. At the same time, I also know so many people who are young and they consider themselves to be old. Now, what is this definition of old age? It started off with the British. You see, before the British came in, we had a very flexible society. People used to be in agriculture or this or that, whatever they are doing. And there was no such thing as retirement. So as long as a person is physically fit and fine, he used to, you know, keep working. When he realized that physically he is not fit enough, he would sit at home and pass the baton to his younger people in the family. That's how it used to go. The British originally came up, when they set up the British offices, the government offices, they brought in this concept of superannuation, retirement. And they started off with an age of 50. Because when the British were here, the average longevity of an Indian was less than 30 years. So by the time a person used to reach 50, he used to start getting weaker and not enough competent. His eyesight may be failing, he may not be able to walk properly, he may not be able to think properly. Then they jacked it up to 55. When independence came, the average age of an Indian rose up to 45 and retirement age was 55. 70 years after independence, they just raised it up to around 58 or 60. We still have some state governments which retire people at 55. See where the world has gone and see where we are. Anyway, the point here is, I'm not talking about government and rules and regulations. What I am talking about is the fact that when a person works hard, when he has got a position, when he has got some responsibility, he considers himself to be an active and a productive member of society. When the superannuation comes, no, let's say it is 60, that's the maximum more or less in most places today. If you are in any organized setup, government, this, that, public sector, wherever you are, they say that this person has age. He may be very competent. He's got years of experience. He has developed certain skills which his juniors don't have, and he is doing very well in his work. But there is that rubber stamp, 60th birthday, retired, out. And that has a great impact on people. If you or any family member or any close friend is in this organized sector, where they retire at 58, 60, whatever the age they retire at, please help them to prepare that retirement does not mean you have become old. Retirement and old age are in no way connected to each other. A person may still be on active duty and may have become old. A person may have retired 20 years back and he may still be fit and fine and active. In fact, when certain government departments like the Income Tax Training Institute, Reserve Bank of India, even the military branch, they asked me to take workshops on retirement planning to help people who are going to retire and the changes that they will come in their life and how they will cope with it. After a few sessions, when I interacted closely with these people and I asked them, what do you think you are going to be doing now that you have retired? And most of these people have pension. So it's not even as though that, they will be financially dependent. They will get their provident fund, gratuity. They will have their pension. If their children are settled, they have no obligation. They may by the time have built their own house or apartment or whatever it is. So that means that they can now sit back and relax and enjoy the fruits of their 30-40 years of hard work. But no, most of the people I met wanted to do something more. They said that 60 is ridiculous time to, you know, sit back. I can do so much more. So you know what I did? I changed the topic of my session to second career planning. And that is what I tell people who are in the organized sector. Now, what about those who are homemakers or people who are, you know, private practitioners or consultants or whatever it is? They don't have any superannuation age. So their work entirely depends on two things. One is their competency, both physical and mental. And the second is their motivation, their attitude towards life. If they have a positive attitude, which is what I have always tried to inculcate in people who are crossing the so-called barriers of 60 or whatever it is, I have always tried to tell them, look at the positive side of things. Look at the factor that you will now be free of so many responsibilities. Most of them by that time have settled their children. So you don't have responsibility of the upbringing of your children or paying for their education or whatever. Most have made an accommodation for themselves. Most have made some health insurance or whatever it is. They may have their own vehicle. They may have so many things. They may have membership of a club or whatever they like for recreation. If you do that, you can look forward to retirement as the age in which you can really live it up. Many, many years back, I think I must have been 48, I think, if I remember right, I wrote a book, Life Begins at 60. And people asked me, how old are you? I said, I'm 48. How do you know life begins at 60? I said, I have the experience of interacting with innumerable people who are above 60. Both organized sector, people who are retiring, and unorganized sector, like homemakers, consultants, whatever it is. And whatever I am presenting is a sum total of the experiences of all these people. Some who have given up on life and said, now I'm too old, I don't know, I may die, my health is going down, I don't know how long I'll survive. And some who said, now things are better and I will move on. I still remember a very lovely anecdote, real life. A student of mine, one day, you know, called up and said, my husband has just retired. She's a homemaker. So she said, my husband has just retired. I said, how is your experience after your husband's retirement? She put it so beautifully. She said, half the income and double the husband. Earlier, I used to see him only half part of the day. Now he's here at home 24 hours. Earlier, we used to have a certain income. Now his pension is only half of what he used to earn as salary. Now, what does that indicate? That indicates that you are not looking at retirement in a positive way. What about those, as I said, who are not working in the organized sector, including homemakers? There's obviously no retirement for them. The other day, a colleague of ours celebrated her son's marriage. And I was recollecting with her that there were these good old days when ladies used to say, once my son gets married and brings a wife, jab bahu ghar pe aayegi, to I will relinquish all my responsibilities. I worked so hard. I will hand over the bunch of keys to her and then she has to do the work and I will sit back and relax. Today, you know what they are saying? As it is, I had to take care of my husband and my son. Now I have one more person to take care of because the daughter-in-law is busy doing her work and running around and stuff like that. So the homemaker has to continue with additional responsibility of one more mouth to feed. But this is only a question of how you look at things, you know. What is your perspective towards things? It can be very positive, it can be negative. The most important thing to remember why I took up this topic is, compared to earlier, as I was telling you that once upon a time, longevity and the lifespan of Indians used to be about 30 years, then it went up to 45 when the independence came. Today it has crossed 75. And women, mostly homemakers, have a longer lifespan than their husbands. So, if we say 75 is the average lifespan, if you minus off those people who die very young or die in accidents or some, you know, serious ailment and all that, if you minus all those, you can easily expect the actual lifespan. If something doesn't happen to you, you don't meet with an accident or you don't come across terminal illness or something, your longevity is somewhere around 85 or 90, maybe more. Now, do you have a vision to think that far ahead? Because the second thing to keep in mind is, healthcare has improved significantly. Earlier also, a few people used to live up to 80, 90, 100 also. But what would happen? They would probably, their eyesight would be weakened and they would not be able to see properly. Their hearing would go bad and they wouldn't be able to hear and therefore carry out a conversation. They would have things like rheumatic arthritis. They couldn't walk, so they couldn't go out and do things, Heart problem. You remember those good old days when people used to have a heart attack? And after that, everybody used to say, he's a heart patient. Don't stress him out. He should not climb stairs. Don't make him angry because his blood pressure will go up. He's a heart patient. Today, I know heart patients who have undergone major heart surgery. They are flying planes. They are doing top-notch executive jobs. And they are even doing surgery to other people's hearts. So that is where healthcare has gone. So if you are going to live up to 90 or 100, chances are that you will also be able to live a good quality of life. That is very important. Just surviving and struggling like old people used to do in the good old days was not a great thing. Today, they are able to live a decent quality of life. They are able to be productive members of society. And this is going to increase more and more. Let me tell you that by the time you reach 80, 90, every part of your body will be replaceable except the brain. Take care of your brain. Take care of your mind. Have a positive attitude. Do mental exercises. Be optimistic. Plan for the future. And body will not be a constraint. That is what I want you to start thinking if you have not thought of it. Whether now you are 70 or 17, it does not make a difference. You have to start planning now. And that is why I took up this topic of today. Because the idea is that growing old is just a chronological development. Somebody says that I am 49, somebody says I am 74. What is the difference between the 49 and the 74-year old? So what is happening is that getting old implies that the individual is feeling the negative effects of aging, physically or mentally. If you ensure that you are not facing or feeling the negative effects of aging mentally, physically your doctor will be able to take care of everything else. And by the time you reach old age, whatever your definition of it is, if you have done simple things like maybe having a health insurance and this and that, then you know that any of these ailments which come with old age can be taken care of. And you will not have any problem in leading a good quality of life. Let me also, you know, touch upon something which has been causing attention of people. Many young people who are supposedly fit and fine, they spend 1.5 hour in the gym. They maintain their health. They eat very good quality food. They are very active. And suddenly they have a heart attack and they die. There have been more and more cases, some celebrity cases also like these. So I was wondering what could have gone wrong. I have a very, very eminent and a very wise doctor, Dr. Rajiv Lokhande. I was talking to him and he explained this phenomenon to me. He said, physical, you know, exercises and keeping yourself fit does not mean spending 1.5 hour in the gym and spending 22.5 hours in front of the laptop. Your body, your mind is not meant to be like that. In the olden days, people used to do physical exercise from the time they got up to the time they went to sleep. The moment they got up, they had to go and collect water from somewhere. Even if they had to go to the loo, they had to go out in the fields and come back. They had to get the grass and feed the cow. Then they had to do something else. Then they had to walk down to their field. The whole day would go on with exercise. You can't do it just 1 hour in a day and expect to be fit and fine. And the second factor is, even if you are taking care of your body physically, doing everything possible, eating the best of food, maintaining nutrition and diet and everything, you are, you know, exercising rigorously, you're doing everything, but if your mind is not responding, if your mind is getting old, you're not going to last out very long. And whatever time you last out also, your quality of life will not be good. And once you understand that, you understand a very simple formula. I had read this in that, cartoon strip of Peanuts. There's one kid who's telling the other one, "You only live once, isn't it?" The other child tells him, "No. You only die once. You live every day." This is the wisdom of children, which we forget when we grow up and think of ourselves as mature adults. Now, I suppose all of you are aware that there is only one ailment, old age ailment, which is totally, so far, incurable. And that is dementia. Alzheimer's disease, as we call it. If I develop dementia at any age, it could be at 60, it could be at 90, and my brain atrophies, my memory starts failing, I start becoming dysfunctional, then there's nothing I can do. But even though there is no cure for Alzheimer's, there are ways and means to prevent Alzheimer's. The simplest one being, use all parts of your brain. If you use all parts of your brain, your chances of getting Alzheimer's are much less than somebody who all his life was an accountant, all his life was a computer engineer, all his life was a lawyer, or all his life was an artist. Because he is using only those particular aspects of the brain. And the other parts of the brain which he is not using are more prone to the atrophy, the sort of, you know, rotting away of that part of the brain. And that leads to these forms of dementia. At the same time, there's another aspect which you need to keep in mind. Accept your age, your chronological age. Don't run away from it. I know of people who don't want to admit their age because they don't want, you know, to be known as old people. One of the simplest things that I do when I come across somebody, you know, who tries to pretend that I am very young, maybe a person, let's say, in his 40s, And he tries to, you know, do everything to look such a way that nobody would believe that this person is 40 years old. You know what trick I do? I give them something to read. And the moment he either takes out his reading glasses or he even starts looking at it like this, I know he is over 40. So what is there in admitting it? Why do people try to pretend to be younger than they are? People who do that, who do not accept their chronological age, have greater chances of suffering as they grow older and older. Firstly, accept your age. As I said, whether you are 16 or 60, it doesn't matter. Then say, what am I capable of doing? Yes, as you grow older, there will be certain things which you will not be able to do, which you will have to shorten down. Supposing you are a very avid cricket player. You used to run around doing batting, fielding, bowling, everything. Maybe as you grow old, you may not be able to do it. Switch over to maybe table tennis. Switch over to playing carom. You can still be actively involved in sports without taking up sporting activity, which requires too much of physical activity. So this way, once you accept your age, start looking for ways and means in which you can actually, you know, work on bringing about that transformation that comes. One more thing which I have always seen, which, you know, cuts down the longevity and the, you know, the lifespan of a person, is addictions, primarily to alcohol or drugs, even to cigarettes. Very, very dangerous. People don't consider nicotine addiction as bad as alcohol or drugs, but it is. It can cut down firstly the quality of your life and secondly the longevity of your life. And now, in the next generation, I am not sure how this is going to affect people who are getting addicted to the screen, because they are shutting themselves off from the outside world. Their world is confining to that 6 inch of the mobile or 16 inch of the laptop. When you yourself are shutting yourself away from the world, the nature, the panorama of views miles ahead, and you shut yourself up, you are definitely going to grow older. Dr. Lokhande also talks about things like, you know, blood pressure, diabetes. He said these are not illnesses. These are lifestyle disorders. And medication only acts as a momentary controller of that disorder. It does not, you know, cure it. If you want to ensure that you don't become a victim of blood pressure or diabetes and all that, change your lifestyle. I'm not an expert to tell you how and what. You can talk to your doctor. If that doctor is a very, you know, open-minded person or a nutritionist or whatever it is, you change your lifestyle and automatically on a permanent basis, your blood pressure will come under control, your blood sugar will come under control. So many parameters will come under control. And when we talk about exercise, it has been proven time and again that there is nothing as good as simple walking. Brisk walking is an exercise which doesn't cost you money. You can do it any time of the day. You can do it anywhere you are. And you can do it for any duration. While many people recommend that 45 minutes is the minimum that you should be walking at least 5-6 days a week and all that. But okay, in the morning you are busy, do 15 minutes of walking, nothing wrong. In the evening you have free time, do another 30 minutes of walking. These are the things which are going to determine a lot of factors as you grow older and older. The other thing is, I find people, some people, who as they grow older, they tend to become more short-tempered, irritable. They talk about good old days. In my days, this never used to happen. In my days, that never used to happen. I can't tolerate these youngsters. That is a sure shot for rapid decline in your quality of life, which eventually leads to cutting down on your life. See, death is unpredictable. Anytime anybody can face death, that's not an issue. But as long as you are around for whatever age, ensure that you live a decent quality of life. Why does that happen, you see? Things like migraines. Doctors say there's no cure for it. And people find a cure within themselves. They suddenly say, I've suffered from migraine for so many years. Now suddenly it went away and I don't have migraines. Think why that happens. I'm not going to tell you. I want you to explore and see. That is how you improve your quality of life. Use all parts of your body. Like I told you, use all parts of your brain. Use all parts of your body for exercise. There is a thing called gross motor skills, the wide movement. And there is a thing called fine motor skills. You hold a pen and you write or you draw something. See that your gross motor skills and your fine motor skills are both given sufficient exercise so that it remains. People in their old age who find their hand shaking, they can't write properly, they can't hold a cup properly, is because they have not nurtured their gross and fine motor skills. And once that happens, obviously they start feeling old. They say, I can't even do this, I can't do that. And because of that, they start feeling older. The mind accepts that you have become old, and the mind starts preparing you for a downturn, both in terms of your quality of life and the extensivity of your life. This is what all of us can work on. It takes a little bit of effort here and there, nothing much. But as I mentioned in the beginning, I'll say that again in the end, that your quality of life should start improving in these manners, regardless of what age you are in. You should be persistent. You should look forward to old age as the best age of your life, because you have the freedom, you have the satisfaction that you have fulfilled all your basic duties. And now, whether you are going to live 4 years or 40 years, look forward to that quality of life. So keep that in mind. I will, as usual, take a quick 1 minute break. And Nikhat is here to update you on what's happening in Banjara. Then we'll start our discussion. Over to Nikhat.
Good afternoon, youthful folk. While all of you are waiting for some rain showers, I'm here to give shower with you with some announcement and some news. I'd like you to pause and reflect, because Ali is coming up with a mindfulness program on the 1st of June between 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at Banjara Academy, Atinagar. Also, registrations to our program, Diploma in Counseling Skills, is coming to a close. All those of you interested or your loved ones who may be interested in this reflective journey, please do get in touch with the office. And last but not the least is we offer free counseling online, email, as well as telephonic and in-person counseling, which is absolutely free of cost across all languages at the center. And I've turned 40, and I just wanted to let you all know that my trick to keep myself childlike and youthful is to come back to Banjara and spend as much time with the youngest people that I have found. And most importantly, of course, not Baba, but baby Ali. And here's back to Ali.
Ha! Nikhat is bluffing. She has not turned 40. If you meet her and spend some time with her, you will wonder whether she is finished with her teenage or not. Right? So, we have moved to the second part of our session. And other than the wonderful good afternoon, and hi all, and good afternoon Banjara team and all that, we have started getting a few comments or questions. I request all of you to please voice yourself. I learn a lot. All of us as a group learn a lot when you share. There's no such thing as right and wrong in human behavior, no? So start thinking and putting out your, comments. Parvin also says good afternoon. But Surekha, who's always there with some very insightful and very unique, thoughts. That's one thing that I've always appreciated of her. And I can assure you that she will never grow old when she has a mind which is so active and an attitude which is so positive. Now, Surekha says, there are people at 20 who are ancient and there are people at 90 who are young. I am at peace with my age. For me, it's always the now. And that's what I'm going to do also on 1st of June, the mindfulness workshop, which is a beginning to do a lot of work in mindfulness. I've been doing it for the last few years, but I've never put it out in the form of a workshop. So those who are interested can come and attend on 1st of June, Saturday, for the first half of the day, that is 10 to 1. You can check with the office all the details and register. But as Surekha rightly said, for me, it's always the now. If you can learn to do that, your past experiences and your past stressors and your past negative things that have happened to you fade off, and the anxiety of the future also reduces. That is what you need to keep in mind. Okay, after Surekha we have Surekha has made one more suggestion. That's very nice. I believe what important is not how long we live, but how we live. You remember that old Bollywood comment, Zindagi badi honi chahiye mere dost, lambi nahi. So, Surekha says, I believe what is important is not how long we live, but how we live. How we live every day, every year, every minute. For if our life does not matter, then it really doesn't matter how long we live, isn't it? If you are not valuing your own life, if your self-esteem is low, if you really feel that life is bad, I'm not being able to do anything, I can't do this or that, if you have that attitude, does it make a difference whether you're going to be living 5 years more or 50 years more, isn't it? That's what Surekha has brought us to us, and I 100% agree with her. Okay, then we have some more hi and good afternoons, and then we have what is the next? Rina says, how do you stop thinking of the past? Very good question, Rina. See, we cannot forget the past, right? That proverb which says, forgive and forget, I don't believe in it. Because you cannot forget, your mind is functional. You will only forget if you develop dementia, and nobody wants to develop dementia, right? So, let us not aim towards forgetting the past. Let us aim towards resolving the past. Something bad happened to me yesterday, last year, 10 years back, right? It is painful. It is hurting me. But if I resolve it in my own mind, why it happened, how it happened, if I learn lessons from the past, somebody cheated me, somebody let me down, I was irresponsible, so I had an accident, I did not judge somebody properly, therefore, I lost a relationship. Past can actually be used to learn lessons for the future. That attitude, if I have gone through 10 bad experiences in my life, it is 10 lessons learned. I am a very, very fortunate person. People who have never had a bad past, never had any setbacks, when the first setback comes, they are not mentally prepared. I've seen people collapsing when they have led such a beautiful and unconditional life, and suddenly one obstacle comes, one challenge comes, and they are not able to deal with it. So that is why treat your past experiences in a positive manner. Okay, Parveen says, I agree with Nikhat that you are the youngest member here by heart. Okay, fine, yes. So why don't you compete with Nikhat and become younger than her? See, chronologically you will grow older, but you can actually mentally and emotionally become younger. One of... Yeah, I know. Whoever it is, whether it is me, whether it is Nikhat, whether it is anybody, what I am saying is, for example, as you saw just now in the beginning, some of you may have missed out, you know, our Yasmin is here with us. She was a very active member of her batch when she did DCS. Then she has moved to Mysore. But whenever possible, she comes, and today she came to know that FB Life is there. She said, I am going to talk to these people. That is what makes a person younger. Oh no, I am not in Bangalore anymore. I have moved to Mysore. I can't come every now and then to Banjara. What do I do? That makes a person older. So just understand these very fundamental and very, very basic things. You will not have to worry about it at all. Surekha's, I've already read out both of them. Then
Surekha again says the fountain.
Yes, Madanlal ji, all the way from Rajasthan, joins us, wishes us. I'm thankful to you, Madanlal ji. Aap kaise hain? Namaskar. He is spreading the word. He's an ex-Air Force officer who is now working for the youth of his village and town, doing excellent work there. It's always a pleasure to have him with us on these Saturday things. Nikhat says the fountain of... Surekha says the fountain of youth is in our minds, in our talents, and in our privilege to touch lives. Very well said. And when we tap into it, we have defeated age. I remember when I had gone to Bumrauli, the headquarters of the Central Air Command of the Indian Air Force. They took me to Allahabad and they took me to that big fort, from where you can look down and see Ganga ji and Yamuna ji merging in the Sangam. But there is a temple up there which is supposed to be the birthplace of Saraswati River. People can't see it. But people have faith that this is where Saraswati evolves from. And that adds life to the Sangam. Now people come from hundreds of miles away to watch the birthplace of Saraswati. Whereas physically you cannot see water there. Yet it is these type of faith which takes life ahead and keeps you younger. Yes, Parveen says, I am 56 years young now, whereas once I was 40 years old. That's exactly what I am saying. And I hope, Parveen, one day you will be 96 years youngest, isn't it? I've actually seen that in all my years of life and all my decades of life. I've had such wonderful experiences of seeing people. I had another wonderful, Parsi friend whose name was Khusro. And he was already in his 90s when I met him. And it is amazing, his thirst for knowledge. Anything new that is happening, he would say, mere ko ye dekhne ka hai, mere ko ye seekhne ka hai. Right from a new dish which one of the staff members would have bought for lunch, to a new development in the computer, to a new project that we have taken up, he would be curious about learning about everything. And that's what kept him young. Till his last day, he spent the day outside, met people, went to the fire temple, came back, went to sleep, and did not wake up. Isn't that really wonderful quality of life? Okay.
Please make mindfulness workshop online
also, Rupa Sri. Yes, we'll try. Let me go ahead with this workshop, see how the outcome is and see whether it is possible to put it online. If it is, you know, convenient and if it seems to be fitting in, I will definitely keep that in mind. Thanks for that, suggestion. Okay, then we have, I noticed one or two others which we have missed out. No, where is, Sharayu says, good afternoon. And Asha says, determination also plays an important role in keeping the mind and body on track. Yes, Asha, I agree with you. Determination, motivation, enthusiasm, optimism. These are different words and different traits, but they come under the same banner. So if you have that determination, I would even add to that patience, consistency. Make a list of these words and check yourself, am I really following all these or not? If you're doing it, you can look forward to a wonderful quality of life. We are using a new screen today, so there is a little bit of technical learning. So some of those messages are getting repeated or something is happening. We'll set it right by next Saturday. That won't be a problem. But as of now, you'll have to bear with us because as we keep flipping up and down, we come across some of the comments which we are either missing. Parveen also says that I will join you if you're doing it. Sonia says, I love trying. Where did Sonia go? Just a second, please. Sonia says, I love trying and learning new things, which gives me the feeling of being a student and like a school kid. I feel now when kids are settled, I enrolled for the course of B.Ed. too. Wonderful, Sonia. That's the spirit. We had a student in DCS who was well into his 80s. And for 10 years after that, he practiced counseling very actively. He never said, I'm past 80. What should I learn now? What should I do? He actually became a school kid and he went through that, program. Then, Surekha says, when a 102-year-old woman was asked about how it feels to be 102, she said, freaking awesome. No peer pressure at all. Yes, I've heard of that, Surekha. That was a wonderful thing. No peer pressure. How many people are there of your age to put pressure on you? You can live such an independent life. In fact, there was a wonderful movie called 102 Not Out. It was starring Amitabh Bachchan and his son was played by Rishi Kapoor. It's a wonderful movie. Please see it to understand the positive aspects of older age. Rupa says, is thinking of future a lot make you a responsible person? Yes and no, Rupa, both. When you say thinking a lot, some of us go into brooding a lot. What will happen when I grow old? Who will look after me? One of the things which I keep hearing very often is, mothers of daughters who have grown up a little more than the marriageable age, that, if you don't marry now, who will take care of you in your old age? I laugh to think that this girl gets married expecting that my husband will take care of me in my old age. She will probably have to take care of him in the older age. There are two sides of the coin. But that's what I am saying, that, when you think about the future, it doesn't necessarily make you a responsible person. But if you can think and plan and take some precautions about your future so that you don't suffer because of something else. For example, old age ailments will come. Do you have a good doctor starting with that? I believe that every person should have a personal physician as you grow older, who knows you in and out since number of years, and the moment you say something, the person will be able to judge and tell you what is happening. You should also have, as far as possible, a medical insurance so that you don't have to spend money, you don't have to, you know, go back from some treatment just because you cannot afford it. Lakshmi Bhai says, hi Ali ji.
Roshan says,
my sister-in-law, who is 96 years old now, agrees with me that it is your thoughts that make you old or young. Always thinking positively and telling the negative thoughts to be out keeps you one young all the time. One can easily reach the age of 100 with positive thinking for yourself and others. Keep active, smiling, and overcome hurdles without any struggles. With struggles also, no? Why only without struggles? There are struggles. Some obstacles, some hurdles have to require a lot of effort. You need to do that also. Why run away from that? You can do it. These are all very simple things of life. I keep telling you, no, nothing that I tell you in these Saturday sessions is rocket science or something which is a great invention or anything like that. It is just that, are we practicing it? That's what I come back to. Cognitively knowing something, yes, I have to exercise, I have to use all parts of my brain, I have to be optimistic. You can think that way, but that does not help. Sharayu, Dr. Sharayu from Dharwad, is also very actively involved with us. I really look forward to her. Spend more time with youngsters. Keep the child in you alive. Definitely, that's a wonderful formula. Dr. Sharayu, I'm glad that you have pointed that out. As you grow older, do not compete with the youngsters. Do not look down upon them. Don't say, I have got so much experience, I'm so much older, or something like that. Make friends with them and learn from them, because today's youngsters know much more than what the older generation had learned. Use them as your teachers, as your mentors, as your guides, and you can learn wonderful things from them. Renu says, how to stop being insecure as we grow old? Yes, insecurity, anxiety, doubts about what will happen, this feeling that if I become incapable, what will happen? If I don't have money, what will happen? If my children don't take care of me, what will happen? If I lose my life partner, what will happen? These are the type of insecurities which come to people at the time of, when you think that age is catching up with you. One of the simplest things that I always recommend is do what we call as the worst case scenario. In the worst case, what will happen? For example, I know so many homemakers who have never gone out of the house and done neither work nor even simple things like banking or government offices work and this and that. They always left it to their husband. One fine day, the husband is no more. And you should see how much they have risen to the occasion, how well they have caught up, taken responsibility, enjoyed doing everything. So that is only that sense of insecurity or anxiety which keeps plaguing you. Say, whatever happens, I will deal with it at that time. Today, if I have somebody to take care of my needs, I am thankful, I owe gratitude, I will reciprocate in whatever manner. Tomorrow, if I do not have this, so be it. I'll face up with it at that time. Renu says, good health brings positiveness, but health falls for dependency makes
people frustrated.
Frustrated. Agreed. Physical dependency can make a person very frustrated. If I come down with an illness and I am bedridden, my thoughts will go haywire. I can start thinking the worst and I can feel so bad that somebody has to give me food, somebody has to give me water, somebody has to help me with this and that. It can be bad. But if you accept it as part of life, that's what I was telling you, that accept it. It does happen. Maybe that's another wonderful thing. I have seen people who have been extremely sick and others, including doctors, gave up on them and they bounced back. Miracles do happen. But miracles are supported by your own mental strength. Your physical strength may have gone down and that's why you are on bed. But if you have the mental strength, I have seen people recovering from second stage, third stage cancer and coming back to lead very good normal lives. A lot of that, of course, the oncologist and the doctors play a very significant role. I'm not belittling that. But along with that, the positive mindset, the determination, all these things matter a lot. Keeping that into account, as long as we are practicing and doing whatever has to be done, Surekha says, our character, our principles, our faith, and our storehouse of values are not subject to decay. Yes, again, very well said, Surekha. These are our assets as we grow older. As we grow physically a little weaker and we come down, we cannot do a lot of activities which we used to do in young age. These are the things which take us forward. When you can hold your head up high, regardless of your age, and say, I have not been some great celebrity or the richest person or the most powerful person, but I have led a life with basic principles, values. I have not consciously or purposefully disturbed or harmed anybody. I have always been expressed gratitude and felt gratitude to whatever good things have happened to me. And taking that into account, we should move out. Like Sharayu says, let age not change us. We should change the way we age. Very nice. I think this can be a proverb which we can use and put up, you know, to give us that positive thinking. So as we are coming to the end of our session, Parveen says, changing what if to even if. Yes, instead of what if, change to even if makes you get rid of overthinking and anxiety. What if this happens? How will I survive? Change to, as Parveen says, even if I develop illness, even if I have financial problems, even if I have this, I will still run my life. So with that, there are still a few more comments left. I'm sorry, we have run out of time, but I'm really glad at your participation and the way you have been interacting, giving us very good insights and telling us so many things. I keep learning every Saturday. So with that, let me sign off and I will meet up with you next Saturday at the same time at 2:00. Thank you and bye-bye.